Hello! In the last episode, I introduced you to my new boat, a 20-foot cabin cruiser. Whoa. And I began taking it down the canal towards Stourport.
Good morning. All things considered, I slept pretty well. Went to bed at about 9:30. The sleeping bag served its purpose and kept me warm. The only slightly annoying thing is the flag on the front of the boat was clattering around in the wind and making a bit of a banging noise, so I need to take that off or something. Today the plan is to get to Stourport. First things first, breakfast, which will be a cup of tea and a banana.
Meals on this trip were necessarily limited due to no fridge and basic cooking gear. A glorious second day of boating beckoned, with sunshine and no breeze. It was rather splendid to be waking up to look out over water once again, but reality was rather setting in as well.
In the cold light of day, I have to confess, the euphoria of the initial purchase is slightly wearing off, and as I look around the boat, which is very small, but there are so many things that need tweaking or fixing, a surprising number of things, it could be a huge project. I'm wondering if I've bitten off more than I can chew here.
I took the canopies down. You can't sensibly travel with them up, as you can't see what you're doing. There must be a better way to fold these, though. Then it was time to start the outboard from cold.
Right, here we go again. Choke out. Squidge the squidgy fuel thing, which should still be primed from yesterday anyway.
Whoa. Success, or so I thought.
It stopped after about a minute. I must have pushed the choke in too soon. We'll give it another pull. And we're off. It is a lovely day.
The birds chirped a chorus of good mornings as I went along. There was a cottage along here that was for sale recently. It had no access by road, only by boat. Gorgeous place it was. I'd have 7 locks to go through before Stourport, and the first was Whittington Lock.
Well, that was handy, another boater coming up behind me, who then shut the gates after I left, so I didn't have to stop and go back. So that was handy. Quite a long stretch now to the next lock, which is Debdale Lock.
With the boat being awkward about going slowly, essentially, the throttle would drop back into neutral if I didn't give it a firm shove forwards. Progress was unnecessarily swift. I just added it to the list of things that need sorting and hoped the Canal and River Trust would forgive me since the wash off the boat was negligible. I was travelling with fenders down, which on narrowboats is a sin, but the rules are different with cruisers.
It's the same as how BMW drivers don't have to use their indicators, and van drivers can park anywhere legitimately as long as they put their flashing hazard lights on. It's the same sort of rule with fenders and fiberglass boats.
I speak as a van driver myself, so I'm allowed to make that observation. Oh, look, horses! My bow camera had fallen off from its suction mount after 2 hours the previous day, thankfully not into the canal. In good news, I was starting to get to grips with the steering. At least, I thought I was, but the difference between this boat and my previous 56-foot-long 15-ton narrowboat was at the forefront of my mind.
The thing I forgot yesterday when I said there were three things. That third thing is the steering. It is very different to steering a narrowboat, or maybe just any boat with a tiller, I'm not sure, but yes, steering with a wheel and a little boat and a very light boat, outboard at the back, it feels more like steering a hovercraft in that you can turn the wheel and the boat turns but still carries on going sideways through the water until it kind of gets a grip and then it'll go forward and then you have to turn it again, and I look like a shambolic amateur. I'm steering all over the canal because it just feels different.
Isn't this garden wonderful? So much effort gone into it. You can tell I'm getting cocky with the steering now, because I'm filming as I go through the bridge hole, and therefore steering one-handed. Uh-oh, another tunnel. I'd better put the camcorder down and pay attention. Made it with no crashes. Perhaps I should have bought a kayak. I've always fancied having a go at that. Overall, I was settling nicely into day two.
It can be the silliest little things that bring you joy. On the narrowboat, the pages of the map book would get blown over by the wind just as I was going along. And just having that little tiny windscreen means everything is that little bit more sheltered and everything stays where it should be. And this brings me a ridiculous amount of joy.
Also joyous, with apologies to the folk who liked it, was having removed the flag, as I could see where I was going now. This sticker was already there, but it's very apt. Hooray! A heron! I knew there had to be one to make the trip complete, and it didn't even fly off. At a beam of 6 feet 8 inches, Twiggy is 2 inches narrower than a narrowboat, which comes in handy in these tight sections. Luckily, nothing was coming the other way. And as I came along here, a lovely compliment for the boat.
A rather lovely lady on a bike on the towpath just stopped to take a photo of Twiggy and said she's gorgeous, which is nice.
This lock is notable for having a tea shop next to it, which I've never stopped at because I'm always passing through on a boat. One day I'll visit by car and have the time. It's a deep old lock, this one, and by crikey, there was a heck of a push from the overflow bywash at the bottom. After going back to shut the lock gates, I came back underneath the road and looked at the flow. No surprise the boat got shoved up against the brickwork and ivy on the way out. At Wolverley Court Lock, the CRT were repairing a damaged bywash, but the lock had reopened so I could pass.
It is starting to get a bit breezy, which is weird because the last time I came along here in the narrowboat, which was 6 years ago, it was also very breezy along here. My aim now is to get to Sainsbury's supermarket, which has a petrol station, where I will go and get a green carton full of petrol for the outboard tank.
I was, at the time, optimistically assuming I'd be able to go out onto the river from Stourport, hence wanting the tank topped up. Little did I know, the weather was to scupper that plan. The sight of houses meant I was coming into the town of Kidderminster, famous for its carpet making. More importantly to me, behind that wall was the Sainsbury's petrol station. Refuelled, I continued through the centre of town, but almost had progress halted by agreeing to let an old narrowboat come in the lock with me.
Just shared the last lock with a very deep-drafted classic narrowboat, and it promptly got stuck on the bottom of the lock. It couldn't get out of the lock, and the chap had to let in more water to sort of swoosh it out the lock. There was him in front and me behind, so I was stuck until it got free.
Rather shamelessly, I left them in my wake and sped ahead to do the next lock solo because I didn't want to risk that happening again. Past the little basin in town, and here's Caldwell Lock, which I shot through as fast as I could. The narrowboat caught up just as I was finishing. So onwards under the Falling Sands Viaduct, built in 1877 and extensively repaired in the last 5 years by the Heritage Severn Valley Railway. The pleasure of the sunshine and being on the water again was very cheering as I headed along the final stretch between Kidderminster and Stourport. There's a derelict lock under this bridge, which once took the canal down to the River Stour below, used to connect factories to an ironworks down there. Fiery autumn colours are just the best, aren't they? And this is Stourport, the final strait having loads of space to moor with a marina basin at the bottom. My plan was to go out onto the river, but this was delayed a lot by bad weather. So for now, this is where the trip ends.
And there we are, end of day two, inexpertly moored, but we made it.
Cheerio.